Well, good morning. Good morning. It's great to have you today. We do want to welcome you if you're joining us online on Facebook. Thank you for joining us today. Would you do this? Would you take out your Bibles, turn to the book of Genesis, which should be easy to find. Genesis chapter number 18. I'm going to preach a message today called Lead the Way. I'm going to preach to men. Is that okay? I'll try that one more time. Is that okay if I preach to the men? All the ladies said, please, Jesus, please say something. Do something. Pastor, please help. I've been trying for years and years. Well, I want to preach to the men today. And the funny thing about times when I've preached to men different nations, different places. I've done a whole series on men, and the women just say, thank you for that. Thank you for that. I do want to preach to men on this Father's Day. I have said for years that there is an answer to the issues that we face today. I talked to a man this week who was a little older. He said, Pastor, I was born in 1936, and I've never seen it this bad. I've never seen it this bad. He was born in 1936, and he said, it's as bad as it's ever been to my world. And I said, well, you know, here's the answer. There is an answer. Nobody's asked me. The president hasn't called me. The governor hasn't emailed me, but I do know the answer. The answer is this. If men would step up spiritually, we can heal our nation and our world. I believe that with all of my heart, if men would just step up spiritually. So I want to talk to you today about men. You know, God has always and is always looking for a man. He really is. I want to share some scriptures with you today before we even get to the book of Genesis. It says this in Isaiah chapter 41, verse 28, says, this is God talking, for I looked and there was no man. All the single ladies said, amen. I've been looking and there is no man. For I looked and there was no man. Ezekiel chapter 22, verse 30 says, so I sought for a man who would make a wall and stand in the gap. I sought for a man. It's interesting that God is using this verbiage in these verses, and there's others just like it. He's not saying I couldn't find a male. He's saying I can't find a man. There's lots of males. God had searched the earth. His eyes were looking, and there was many males. But he was looking for a man, someone who would step up. God was looking. In Genesis chapter 18, if you're there, I won't go into the entire story. This is the portion of scripture where it talks about the judgment of Sodom and Gomorrah. But God says something specifically about Abraham that I want you to catch today. And we're just going to look at one verse. It says this in Genesis chapter 18, verse number 19, speaking of Abraham. And it says, this is why I've chosen Abraham. It says, for I have known him in order that he may command his children and his household after him, that they may keep the way of the Lord to do righteousness and justice, that the Lord may bring to Abraham what he has spoken to him. God says this, I know Abraham. Before this moment, before I actually chose him, I actually watched his life. God says, look, I've looked for men and I found one in Abraham. I found a man. Listen, it wasn't his skills with weaponry. It wasn't his business acumen. It wasn't his wisdom, his knowledge. It was this. There was something distinct about Abraham. And God said, the reason I'm choosing Abraham is because he knows how to lead his family. He will command his family in two specific areas. Righteousness and justice. Righteousness is that vertical relationship that we have with God. And so God says that Abraham will lead his children into a correct, right relationship with the Lord. He will lead his family that way. But it's also in justice. Justice is our horizontal relationship with man. So God says of Abraham, not only will he lead his family spiritually into a right relationship with me, he will also have a right relationship and lead his family with others into a correct relationship, a just relationship. So you can boil it down to this, that Abraham would lead his family, as God's law says, to love God with all of his heart and to love his neighbor as himself. That's why God chose Abraham. And God has always been looking for a man who is willing to lead, a man who is willing to step up. God is still, to this day, he is searching for men who will step up. I am convinced that what happens, listen to me, church, at your house is more important than what happens at the White House. Do you hear me now? You say, well, Pastor, we have to get the right person in to the White House. We have to vote. Listen, I'm all for voting. I absolutely believe you should vote the Bible. I believe that you should vote according to the standards of God's word, who is going to uphold righteousness. I believe that with all of my heart. But what happens at your house is what determines the course of this nation. Listen, if men would just step up and just lead, if men would just step up from house to house to house to house, we would see a change, a radical transformation in this nation. If men would step up, amen. I believe that with all of my heart, that God is looking for men. He's searching. He is still trying to find men who will lead. If you want a better nation, you need a better man. You need better husbands. You need better fathers. I actually saw a quote this week that I considered kind of offensive. Actually, I saw a lot of quotes this week that were very offensive. I'm just picking one out. But there was this quote this week that I saw that I thought was offensive. The reason why is because I questioned the motive of it. But the quote was this. It was somebody, a leader in the black community. And the quote was this. Somebody posted it. And they said that the greatest problem facing the black community is not racism, it's fatherlessness. Now watch this. The reason why I thought that was offensive is because I've traveled around the world. I've traveled to different nations. And I would argue this, that it's not just the black community that is facing that issue. It's every community. Come on now. That's the greatest problem in every community. Let's not single out. That's why I thought it was offensive, because I thought they're just trying to divert the attention away from America, really, at this moment, needing to do some soul searching. But I found it offensive because it's almost like no other community or no other ethnicity deals with that. And I thought, no, every ethnicity deals with that. Every culture deals with that. Every nation is challenged by that. I have been to the other nations. Guess what? There is a plague upon the earth of fatherlessness. Even fathers who are living in the home, many of them have checked out. They've checked out. And so I see it in every different ethnicity, every different culture. Every different community is facing the same issue. Men who will not step up spiritually. And so we have to face this challenge, and we have to look at it, and we have to say, okay, what can we do to get men to just say, hey, listen, I'm willing to do something that is going to make a difference for eternity, not only in my family, but in those that God has called me to reach. See, I know too many men who know everything about football, but can't quote one scripture. Huh? They make sure their kids don't miss practice, but church is optional. Huh? They follow politics religiously. They just don't follow Christ. And we have to say, hey, we need men who are willing to step up and lead and open up this book and say, God, give me some wisdom. Help me to lead my family. Help me to be a better man, a better father, and a better husband. I want to give you three things, because I could really give you 20. I could give you 20 ways, and then next week 20 more of how we can maybe get better men. But I want to give you three today that I felt like God gave me just for this particular Father's Day. And as a father, I want to give you these three keys. Write these down. Number one is this: be willing to give what you didn't get. Be willing to give what you didn't get. I know many men who would just say, well, you know, my father never did this, so then I won't do that. In other words, they'll say, my father was not affectionate. He never told me he loved me. He never put his arms around me. Therefore, it's just not in me to give. Huh? And I look at that and I go, you know, that's not true. I've seen you with your dog. Come on now. You love that little dog. Look at you, my dog. You know. I've seen you with your dog. Come on now. It's in you. The kids are watching. Man, I wish he loved me like he loved the dog. Come on now. I didn't get that as a kid growing up. I didn't have my father wrap his arms around me all the time. My father never played sports with me. My father never, we didn't do a lot of those things. We never wrestled. But I was just determined that was not going to be me. That was not going to be me. I remember sitting in a meeting up in North Florida with a pastor who was a little older, and he said this. He said, "My greatest regret is never wrestling with my three boys." He said, "And now they're grown, and I don't have the opportunity anymore." He said, "It's my greatest regret." And I remember thinking to myself, that will not be me. So when my son was born, my oldest son, I just said, "Let's go wrestle." And I've said this before, but I said, we broke every bed we ever owned. True story, I used to stick cinder blocks underneath the bed because we had broken them, you know, because we would just wrestle and we would just, you know, flip each other around, and finally we just ended up breaking bed after bed after bed, you know. And now I've got a 9-year-old who weighs about as much as I did when I got married. And so I'm wrestling with him trying not to break this bed because I like this bed, you know what I'm saying? I want to keep this one. And I hear my wife in the other room going, "Hey, go easy on him." I'm like, is she talking to me or him? Because he's on top of me right now. You know what I'm saying? So it's just something I decided I'm going to do. I'm going to tell my kids I love them. I'm going to put my arms around them. I'm going to hug on them. To this day, I've got a 22-year-old and a 19-year-old. I still go lay in bed with them. They'll be in bed. I'll go lay in bed with them and just go next to them and just say, "Hey, what's going on?" And I'll just put my head on their pillow. My daughter won't let me put my feet on the bed, but other than that, I just, feet off, but other than that, I'll just lay there and say, "Hey, what's going on?" And I'll just lay there for as long as they'll let me. I'll just keep laying there. And I just determined I'm going to be affectionate. I'm going to kiss on them. I'm going to love them. I'm going to do my best to embarrass them in front of their friends. They embarrassed me when they were little. I'm going to embarrass them now. Hallelujah. And I don't care. And I didn't get any of that. But guess what? Here's what Romans chapter 5, verse 5 says. It says that the love of God has been poured out in your hearts. So listen to me, church. Listen to me, men. It's in you. It is in you. You can be affectionate. Here, let me give you three words, right? Do it anyway. Do it anyway. Just determine to do it. Amen? Wrestle with your kids. I understand. Listen, when your kids are little, it's called limited time. For those of us who have grown children, you know how fast that time goes by. Amen? Talk to your teenagers. Go lay in bed with them. Huh? Talk to them. Engage them. Listen, there's something about you saying, okay, listen, I may have been raised one way, but I refuse to let that define how I'm going to be a father or be a husband. You are willing to give. Listen, you have the ability, I should say, to give even what you didn't get. Number two is this. Choose to engage and not just be present. Choose to engage and not just be present. I said a moment ago that I believe that it's not just in one community or one ethnicity that there's the challenge of fatherlessness. It's in every ethnicity, every community, every nation, every culture. Do you hear me? And I've seen it. And even though there may be more people present in other cultures, but I know this, that many times being present does not mean you're engaged. You're just present. You're just there. And many of you, maybe you grew up with a dad who was in the house, but he had checked out. In fact, most dads, before they ever leave home, they've already left home. Their hearts are gone before they've ever walked out the door, right? And this lack of engagement is really a challenge to our nation right now. We need men who are willing to engage. Do you know that in Matthew, when Jesus preaches the greatest sermon ever preached, the Sermon on the Mount, he mentions the word Father 17 times. Over and over again. Your Father in heaven. Your Father sees it. Your Father will reward you. Your Father will take care of you. Your Father will feed you. Your Father will clothe you. And over again, including in Matthew chapter 6, verse 9, when he says these words, when you pray, pray like this, our Father in heaven. And with that statement, here's what he does. He defines and reminds people of this. Number one, you have a Father. And number two, he can be found. You don't have to go searching. You know exactly where he is. Even Jesus, when he stood at the tomb of Lazarus and he prayed, he said, Father, I thank you that you hear me when I pray. You always hear me when I pray. Amen. He is not some distant God. He is not just some ideal, some lofty, grandiose, just little principle way off in the distance. He is a God who is close. He is engaged with you. He is there with you. God is interacting with you on a daily basis. I want you to know he's not just present. He is engaged. And listen to me, men, we cannot just be present and think that it's enough. We have to be engaged. Huh? You say, well, I'm here. You're not just a paycheck, right? You're not just a paycheck. You need to be involved. You know, I believe with all my heart that the Bible is very crystal clear when it comes to gay marriage. That gay marriage is outside the boundaries of God's word. I don't mean that in a hateful, spiteful way. I'm just telling you what the word of God teaches. It's very clear. It's not even close. But not only that, here's why we know it's outside the boundaries of God's word, because it makes one gender unnecessary. To say that two men can raise a child should be offensive to every female, because it makes the female unnecessary. Oh, well, there's grandma and there's the aunt. No, no, no. Nothing replaces the female, the mom, in the home. Right? And I want to say to the men, because to think that two women can raise a child, male or female, and give them what that child needs means that the man would be unnecessary. Right? And let me just tell you, men, let me just tell you, listen to me, you are necessary. Hey, guys, hey, we need you. We desperately need you. Right? That's why God created male and female. Because my children get something from me that they can't get from their mom. They just do. And they get something from their mom that they can't get from me. It's called compassion. Right? Right? See, you need both. And you know that the scripture actually teaches that it's the man's job to raise the child, not the woman's. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 4 says, fathers, don't provoke your children to anger, but rather raise them up. Bring them up in the training and admonition of the Lord. Listen, here's what it's saying. Fathers, you raise your child. Huh? You're not just a paycheck. You know, well, I provide. No, you know, I pay the bills around this place. You know, no, it's more than that. There's had to be engagement. There has to be leadership, spiritual leadership. Amen? You have to be willing to discipline when necessary. Hallelujah. I just knew you'd be blessed by that. I could just hear how blessed everybody is. But it is true. We have to be willing to be engaged. Number three is this. Search for purpose and not success. I really don't know how to even define success. I looked it up. Merriam-Webster Dictionary says, one who succeeds. I thought, thank you, that was very helpful. That nailed it. I'm good now. Yeah. One is, how do you define success? I don't even know how to define that word. Is it the fact that you have money in the bank? Is it the career that you've always wanted? How would you define success? Is it now I've got the house that I've always dreamed about? I got my dream house. I've got my dream car. Yeah, but what if you get all that and your marriage falls apart? Are you still considered a success? Huh? What if you get all that and your kids won't speak to you ever again? What if you get all of those goals that you thought you should have and, and wanted to attain and all those things. What if you check every box of every goal you ever wanted to succeed, and then you look back at your life and you realize that those things really didn't matter? It was Francis Chan, who's an author and a pastor, who said this: our greatest fear should not be of failure. Our greatest fear should be of succeeding at things that don't really matter. Our greatest fear should be at succeeding at things that don't really matter. That we look back at our life and we go, I don't know what did I do with all those years? What did I do? You know, I've decided that I really want to leave my kids a good inheritance. Don't tell them. But I've decided that. Financially, I mean. I just want to leave them a good inheritance. It wasn't left to me, but I want to leave it to them. I want to leave them a good financial inheritance. I want to leave something that would be significant. Maybe they could pay off their house. Maybe they could invest the money and just really spring forward in life. I want to do that. The Bible actually says that we're to do that. It says a good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children, right? And so that's a good thing to do, and that takes discipline. And so I want to be able to do that. But if I can't do that, or if I don't get to do that for some reason or another, far more important than leaving them money is for them to look at Dad and go, he fulfilled God's purpose for his life. That's the legacy I want to leave. He was passionate about God. I saw him read his Bible. I saw him make a difference in people's lives. I saw how he cared for people. I saw that he was diligent about the things of God. He taught me about the Word of God. Far more important than money. That's the legacy I want to leave. Amen? See, that's what God has called us to do. He's called us to leave a legacy that's filled with purpose. Do you know that Proverbs chapter 20, verse 5 says this? Counsel is in the heart of man, and it's like a deep water, right? But a man of understanding is able to draw it out. What it's saying is this: there are things that God deposits in you that you have to draw out, right? You have to draw it out. And let me tell you, one of those things is your God-given purpose. You have one. You have a God-given purpose. And it is not to make money, to build a business, or have an incredible career. It is to do what God has called you to do. And it's different for all of us. And the way to find it is to go to the Word of God and say, okay, God, I want to open up this book and open up these pages. And you just diligently keep seeking the Lord, and you keep praying, and you keep reading your Bible. And you say, okay, God, teach me, help me to understand, why am I here on earth? What am I doing here? Because I don't want to get to the end of my life and just have people just speak a few good words over me at a funeral. And I'm remembered by my children and maybe my children's children, but then generations later forgotten. I want to have an eternal impact on somebody and something, right? Do you know in Matthew chapter 4, Jesus is walking along and he finds two men. And one is named Simon and the other is named Andrew. And if you begin to study their life, specifically Simon, we find out the most about, you find that he is rough around the edges, buddy. Foul language, liked to fight. I mean, he was just a rough character, right? And he just was just a fisherman. I mean, just straight out ordinary. He was just an ordinary life. And if Jesus had not called him, Simon would have died Simon, and he'd be completely forgotten. Nobody would even remember him beyond his children and maybe his grandchildren. That's it, right? History would never have recorded his name. But Jesus walks by this ordinary fisherman who is rough around the edges, and he knows that that man has purpose on the inside of him. And he simply says this in Matthew chapter 4. He just says, hey, follow me. He says, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. In other words, there's something inside of you both that is deeper than fish. It is deeper. And whatever it is we do for a living, the 9 to 5 and the collecting of the paychecks and the trying to build the nest eggs and even the hobbies that I love and are necessary and you should have them, beyond all that, there has to be something on the inside of us that we are able to draw from. It's called purpose, that we're able to tap into and say, hey, God, I know that I'm here for a bigger reason than just making money, building a career, having fun on the weekends, and taking great vacations. There has to be something deeper. I'm going to ask Pastor Mark to come today. Listen, men, it's in you. It really is. There is purpose in you. Don't settle for just success. Success is fleeting and it's hard to define, and even when you get it, it can be gone like that, right? Go for purpose. Let your kids see that you are striving to be a man of God. And let me tell you, it is never too late. It's never too late. Huh? I don't care how old you are, how young you are today. There's purpose on the inside of you. I'm going to give you these three things again just for you to understand. Number one is you can give what you even didn't get. You can do that. You can give something. It's in you. There's love inside of you. There's affection inside of you. Huh? There's care and compassion. That's all in there. You may have had a rough childhood, didn't know your father, or maybe you were abused in some fashion. Listen, I'm not minimizing pain, right? But God heals. And guess what? You're able to give it. I did. Nobody taught it to me. I just found it on the inside of me. It was God-given, right? So I just decided, okay, that was it. And then I decided I was going to engage because I was disengaged for so long. I spent years as a disengaged husband, disengaged father. I had checked out. I know what that looks like. I see it in other men all the time. I can recognize it. I can see it coming. And it's a tragedy. I just want to tell them, hey, jump in. It's worth it. Amen. And then number three, I just want to tell you, listen, there's a purpose inside of you. It's so incredible, so great. And when you get to the end of your life, regardless of what you leave for your kids, And I hope that we all leave something, but if we don't, what you need to leave is a testimony of God's goodness, God's grace, God's mercy, and that you fulfilled God's purpose for your life. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes for just a moment? I want to pray for everyone in the room, but I specifically want to pray for our men today. I want to pray for all of the men, those who are dads and those who are granddads here today, maybe a few great-granddads, but I also want to pray for single men today of any age. You're necessary. Listen to me, church. You are necessary. Guys, you're irreplaceable. You're irreplaceable. You're not irreplaceable on the job. You quit your job, they'll find somebody probably. By the time you clean your desk out, they'll have a replacement for you. Guess where you're irreplaceable? You're irreplaceable in your home. There's lots of people that could pastor this church better than me. Huh? There's lots of people that can preach, come up here and preach better than me. But I'm the only one that can be a husband to my wife. I'm the only one that can be a father to Caleb and Hannah and Elias. I'm the only one. In that, I'm irreplaceable. Men, you're irreplaceable. Now, let's shoot higher than success. Let's find God's purpose. Can I pray for you, Father, in the name of Jesus? In fact, guys, would you do this with me today? Would you stand to your feet? I want to do that. Every male in this room, every man in this room, would you stand to your feet? Ladies, would you join me in praying for these men? Would you stretch your hands toward them? Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray for these men. Lord, we thank you for their life. We thank you that there's something on the inside of them that, Lord, you have deposited. There is a destiny. Lord God, I thank you today, Lord, there is purpose residing on the inside of. May we tap into it, Lord. May we understand, God, that time is moving rapidly by. And Father, we need to redeem the time that we have left to live for our God-given purpose. Lord, not that we could do what anybody could do, but we do those things that only you've called us to do, to be the husbands, the fathers that you've called us to be. Lord, I pray for each one of these men, God. I know they're facing battles, they're facing challenges. Lord, they're fighting every day. And Father, I pray today, God, that you'd give them the grace, the mercy, the strength, the wisdom to be the men that you've called them to be. I bless them today. In Jesus' name. Ladies, would you stand and join these men who are standing here today? Hallelujah. Amen. I'm grateful that you joined us on this Father's Day. My kids said, hey, what, Dad, what do you want for Father's Day? I said, a nap. I just want a nap. A good one. It'll be a blessing. Awesome. I'm going to do that today. Don't forget a couple things. First of all, Wednesday night, we start back with our Summer Nights Ablaze services. We're excited about these. And don't forget, we'll have nursery, childcare. We'll have kids' church. Our youth, of course, is meeting on Wednesday nights. And then next week, we actually start back with our kids' ministry. So we have kids' church and nursery next Sunday. Excited about that. Our food pantry kicks back up. The one thing about our food pantry they asked me to mention is that if you need a box of food, you have to reserve it in advance. We'll give you an email this week. If you don't get one, make sure you call the church office, but you should get one. Just letting you know instructions for that. Can I pray a pastoral blessing on you today as you get ready to be dismissed? Or would you just one more time put your hand over your heart, receive this today. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you, be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance towards you and give you peace. In Jesus' name, I call you blessed. Amen. Can we give God praise one more time today? God bless you guys. Thank you for coming today. Happy Father's Day. You are dismissed. God bless you guys.